All right, welcome back to our Wednesday night Bible study on Galatians. We're about to start chapter 4, but it really connects well to chapter 3. I kind of view this as a kind of a poor chapter break spot. So the six verses that we're going to look at today in Galatians 4, 1 through 6 really connect to what we were just reading at the end of chapter 3. We nicknamed our little Bible study here Jesus plus nothing equals everything. So let's look into what we got today. All right. So in chapter 4, verse 1, I mean that the heir, all right, heir there meaning like, you know, the descendant, that you know, the one that is the your son or child that is going to inherit all that you have, as long as he is a child, is no different from a slave, though he is the owner of everything. So when we think about, like, you know, a father, and he's got a whole bunch of people working the field, just picture, you know, kind of picturing that day and age where there are a whole bunch of people, you know, working, you know, your fields and working, you know, to in the crops, and you had servants do some of that, you had employees do some of that, and you had your kids do some of that. And so when you said, hey, it's harvest time, you're hiring tons of people, you got your kids out there, you got your cousins out there. And so in that sense, when it comes to the work, all right, there is no difference between the work, the way I'm talking to them, the way the, hey, what needs to get done and the order it needs to get done. It doesn't seem that there's a difference between, you know, a child and an employee or a servant or a slave. There doesn't seem to be a difference there. And he admits, except he is the owner of everything. And so when we think about the, you know, the child, the heir's point of view, yeah, it might be difficult work. Yeah, it's hot. Yeah, it's this. Yeah, it's that. But at the end of the day, you own all this. This is an investment into your future. And so you should have a different attitude. Even though the actions, the words coming out of the, you know, your father's mouth or your, you know, boss's mouth don't seem different, it should be different to the hearer because they understand that they own everything. It goes on, and this is connecting back to this term that we looked at a couple weeks or last week. But he is under guardians and managers until a date saved by his father. All right, just as we talked about that there is these, you know, whether you call him a tutor or a guardian, whatever it might be, a butler, if we're talking Batman, that there's a predetermined amount of time. You've got this child. He has to learn. He has to understand. He's understanding the business. He's understanding how to work hard. He's studying. He's learning. He's reading. And he's got this tutor, this guardian, this protector that is guiding him until a predetermined time. You know, maybe like in our school system nowadays, maybe something like 18. Back then, it might be something more like 13. Maybe it was a little time after that that they're now learning a trade. And so you're with this person for a little while until you learn this trade. You're with, you know, you're an apprentice until you can learn from the journeyman. All right. And so it's a certain time set by the father. Once this point hits, now you're going to get into it. Maybe you're going to become a manager at this point. I can imagine something like modern day. Okay, hey, you're going to work for the company in the summer. All right, right after school, you're going to work for a couple years, on the site, on the construction site. All right, then you're going to go to college for 4 years. You're going to go get a business degree, an MBA, whatever it is. And when that time is over, then you're going to come into management. You're going to be a VP. You're going to do that for 5 years. And at the end of that, I'm going to make you president of the company and I'm going to retire. You know, so that would be the same kind of equivalent that he's kind of talking about here. All right, that, yeah, it might seem in the beginning days, it doesn't even seem a difference between a child and a slave, an heir and an employee. All right, but they should see it as differently. But when a time has come set by his father, that's going to end. There's going to be an end to this time of study, an end to this time of learning, an end to this time of preparation. And this is what we were talking about when it came to the law, that there was this time of preparation that the law was provided. Now it was multi-generational. You're going to deal with this law for generations to understand this, but a time is coming where this is going to end. We see this in verse 3. In the same way, we also, when we were children, were enslaved to the elementary principles of the world. All right, now there's actually a lot of controversy in this passage. And I'd love for you, I can't even talk all about it if you want to start checking some commentaries. Let me give you what's easy to understand, and let me kind of then say, well, what does he mean by that then? When it uses this phrase, the elementary principles, it really is just one word there, the idea of elemental things. And the most literal meaning is like, lining something up in a row. It makes me think when I read it like Lincoln Logs, or even less something less complex than a Lego. Legos are really hard. But like these little linking logs, these little building blocks that you line things up. When you're a kid, there's a lot of little times where you're just lining little stick. You're lining your little sticks up, see how many you got, count them up, put them into rows. All right, and that's what is this actually referring to? These little like, hey, you're at this point where you're doing these little counting things. You got these little tiny little principle things that you're counting. It's simple, it's easy. It's childish. It's meant to be something you just do. So, like there's so many, I think about school, like, man, we don't sit around doing like, times tables anymore. We don't sit around doing like practicing little songs so that we know the helping verbs, or doing little songs so we can remember like the different parts of DNA. Like that's kind of stuff we go and learn in school. We memorize all the capitals. We don't sit there and kind of like, what is the capital of Vermont? I gotta go. Let me do my little, like, how do I, let me quiz myself. We don't care. And so there's so many little things that we do when we're in that learning stage that we don't do when we finally hit adulthood and we can do whatever we want. Now, the controversial part of this is, what does he mean by this? So some people say that no, the idea of what he's saying here, he's kind of relating this to, like pagans, that they've, literally worshipped, they're enslaved to elementary principles of this world. Think about maybe like astrology, like, uh-oh, you can't hunt after, Hunter's Moon. Oh no, you can't. And there's like, I've heard this like little expression even in modern day, like, red sky at morning, hunters take warning, fishers take warning, red sky at night, hunter's delight, like, oh, there's danger coming on the horizon. Like we have little expressions like that, but imagine like, Jupiter's in retrograde, so you can't go traveling because there'll be danger. You can see how like pagan people of the day use so many little astrological things or other little elementary principled things like, oh, you can't do that because of that. And so there's a possibility that's what he's referring to here, but there's also a possibility that he's referring to, the law itself, which, definitely Jewish people or other people that kind of look very, that look at the laws like, yes, we're still supposed to be obeying it, are almost kind of offended that we would say that, like, yeah, no, the law is elementary principles of the world. And people are like, well, why do you say of the world? Why would you say of the world? Isn't this God's law? Didn't God give it? And yeah, at first it's like, I guess that does seem weird to call the law an elementary principle of the world. The counter argument to that is, many aspects of the law when it comes to what not to do, don't lie, don't steal, don't murder. Like, yeah, that's really similar to like Hammurabi's code, like those kind of things. Don't do these things. I say the unique part of the law is not like the literal what you can and can't do. There's a lot of ancient Near East laws that sound similar. The unique thing is what God does for redemption, for forgiveness. It's the sacrificial system that brings forgiveness, that covers over their sins, is what makes the law unique. There are obviously other aspects of the law too, just kind of a quick thing. The other reason why we might, maybe God is calling elementary principles of this world, like you look at other like pagan religions, there's altars, there's sacrifices, there's temples, like all that stuff kind of seems, we know the difference. There's like a heart difference behind all this stuff. If we were still living in the Old Testament, we would say, yeah, there's a heart difference behind them. We're dealing with an invisible God that is the creator of all things that can't be depicted in human form. But at the end of the day, we got altars, we got sacrifices, we got temples, we got this, we got that. There's things we can't eat, there's blood. And there's a lot of similarities. So he might be kind of saying, like, yeah, you had to know that all that like physical stuff when it came to the law was kind of coming to an end. Like that's the elementary principles of this world. But feel free to do some more study on that, but that's the kind of side I tend to lean on.
Let's look at verse 4. But when the fullness of time had come, God sent forth his son, born of a woman, born under the law. All right. To redeem those who were under the law so we might receive adoption as sons. All right. So let's talk about the first part. I didn't mean to stop at verse 5, but I was like, oh, I shouldn't stop at the middle of a sentence. But when the fullness of time had come, God sent forth his son. I actually really like this verse. It's something I've brought up at, you know, at Christmas time. And in the simplest sense, it's just like, hey, when God's timing said it was ready, it was ready. When God says, well, I'm done with the physical elements of this law, like, and you can see how there's this huge shift from the physical to the spiritual. We go from, you know, physical temples to our heart. We go from, you know, literally having to sacrifice something with blood, like a goat or a bull, to now it's the blood of Christ that covers us, but literally, figuratively, not, or spiritually, I should say. So that there is this shift, and God's like, yeah, when the fullness of time had come, this shift happens to redeem those who are under the law. But on the other way, Jesus is this very physical being that came at kind of the perfect time in history. And I think it was a perfect time for a couple of reasons. Things I've brought up are things like, man, so much of the known world all spoke the same language. You know, much before this and much after this, there isn't something as universal as Greek to be able to spread the good news. The Roman, the Roman Empire, kind of at its height at this point, you know, makes travel for someone like the Apostle Paul relatively easy. He's this Roman citizen. He can travel all over the place. There's a lot of law going on, a lot of justice, a lot of injustices, but a lot of, like, okay, there's court systems that, you know, kind of keep things in order. And the Roman government kind of brought that order. He brought roads. Think about how, you know, it already seems really difficult to travel, you know, 2,000 years ago. How much more difficult is it to travel if there's not roads that can have, you know, horse-drawn carriages and, you know, and other, like, forms and functions that make travel much easier. Same thing with finances, being able to find, who knows, if you can't get your money on yourself, you know, it doesn't work when you go from city to city. Well, there's a large amount of universal income here, not universal income, but there's this large Roman coins that can be used all over this known world for that can be donated from one city to another in the church. So we see a lot of advantages of Christ coming at this particular time in history. And I think there's some other things as well. I'd love for you to chat in the forum here that we have of some other things that you maybe have heard people say, maybe you've heard me say, some other things you've thought to yourself of, like, what's the advantage of Jesus coming kind of right around that 0 AD time, right around this time for that first century? What was the value of him coming at that period of time? But either way, he came at this point to redeem those who were under the law. It does tell us that those who were under the law needed redemption. If they were already, if the redemption going through the sacrificial system was good enough and long lasting enough, God doesn't change anything. Clearly wasn't. You can see there's a need to come for those that are under the law. They need redemption like the rest of us. All right. And ultimately, so that we might receive adoptions as sons. And this is the shift he's making. So often the Jewish people refer to themselves as the sons of God. And that's true. There's a biblical, you know, basis for that. But I don't think they're fully realizing this yet. Because it's talked about as this future promise, as he talked about. The law was, you know, yeah, you were a son, but you're not getting to experience the values of sonship yet. You're still under all these things, you know, temples and rituals and sacrifices, all the laws. You're still under all these rules. And now that the fullness of time has come, the time with you being under the guardian is over. Now it's time for you to get to enjoy what it means to be an heir. Verse 6, and because you are sons, God sent the Spirit of the Son into the hearts, crying, Abba, Father. You are no longer a slave, but a son. And if a son, then an heir through God. All right, so yeah, an Israelite growing up, they're a son, but they're kind of seem still like a slave. They still seem like an employee, still having to do all this stuff. And now, that they've trusted Jesus, their Savior, God has come into their hearts, they get to cry out and call him Abba, Father. I think of the image, just you kind of see this play out. There was such a respect level of God, which, I mean, seems good. I mean, that is a good thing. They wouldn't even say the name of God. They wouldn't write it out in many instances. The Jewish people were almost superstitious. And, like, you know, God gave them this covenant name of Yahweh to call him that. And for many generations, they were like, we can't even do that. Because there was so much respect there. And now he's saying, you can call him Abba, Father. Your heart is now saying he's your Abba. This is much closer to, like, Daddy. All right, and it seems like what I think we see here is this, the relationship changes. I think you've probably seen this with your parents, that there's this relationship change that goes from when you're a child, there is like, you can't, you know, no, you're not going to talk to me like that, and you're going to be respectful. And then when you become an adult, you know what respect still looks like, but you can speak to him, you can speak to your father less cordially. There is a different kind of relationship, and not that you're necessarily like equal in all senses, because you would still be the one to show honor and respect, but there's an equality. You're a working man now, you're a husband now, you're a father now. There is an eye-to-eye-ness that comes with your father in many instances. I'm not sure not everybody experiences that, but I think we see that here in scripture, that now, yep, he's Abba, he's your father, yes, but it's this much more less cordial, more familial, more relational kind of communication. And I think a closer sense, I think probably many of you, like, I know I hear many stories of like, I didn't even like get my father, I didn't get my parent, but now that I'm older, like, man, we have a much better relationship. Cool, that's really cool, you know. And I think that's what God's talking about here. You're no longer a slave, you're a son. You get to act that way, you get to live that way, you get to talk that way, you get to speak that way. You're no longer, it's not you're this little child that might as well just be an employee. You are something different now. So cool stuff. I'd love for you to interact. I got a couple questions for you in the chat. So I love getting interact. I love asking individual questions, and I'll definitely try to keep an eye on it to see if I can respond in some way. Hope you have a great day, and I look forward to seeing you Sunday. I shouldn't be missing any other Sundays for a while, Lord willing. I will see you all soon.